today is Beau Smith. Smith is the American comic book writer and columnist best known for his work for DC Comics, Image Comics, IDW Publishing, and as vice president of marketing for Eclipse Comics.
Yes, Eclipse Comics, Image Comics, Todd McFarlane Productions, and IDW Publishing.
Oh, my Lord.
I found out early, if you're on the business side as well as the creative side, you're never out of a job.
See, that was my first question, actually, was how are you ever bored?
No, that hasn't happened. I haven't been bored in many, many years. Even as a kid, my mind was always making up stories and stuff. And on the business end, it was basically the same thing with marketing. I'd always done marketing here locally. And then in 86, that's when I started in comics and have been doing it ever since, both on the publishing side and the creative side. And it was, I did, because with being creative, being a freelancer, your career goes up and down. You've got times when everything's great and you got a lot of work, you got times when you don't. So I wanted to make sure I always had a day check than the marketing part. And plus, you get to promote your own books that way. So it works out kind of cake and eat it too.
So I do want to ask, because you're talking about there's highs and lows in your career.
No.
At the times that you've hit a low, how did you keep yourself motivated to keep going? Because that seems to be a struggle for a lot of young writers.
It was never a matter of writer's block, as they used to say, but it was just to get that next job. And the time to get that next job was when you were right in the middle of the job you were doing. For example, in the 90s especially, I would be writing, wrote 2.5 years for DC straight, DC Comics at the time. But all that time, I was also doing work for Image Comics, Moonstone Books, and a few others, just constantly at the conventions and at the business seminars, always talking to the editors, always talking to the other publishers to see what we could get going so that once I finished this job, bang, I'd go right into the next one. And it's not being extra smart on my point, it was just, it was hard for someone in the town of West Virginia in a time where there was no internet, you had a phone and that was it, there weren't fax machines, to get into the industry that was mainly just hiring people from the New York area and a little bit outside. So I had to make myself really known to these publishers and these editors to get that to happen. And I remember when fax machines came in. I mean, that was a godsend because it was technology and you could use it to throw pitches in and get them done immediately. But there was a lot of things I had to, I wrote a book in the 90s, How to Market Yourself in Comics, and it was just very bare bones, blue collar of how to do it, what I did. And again, even at that point, the internet was just starting social media. Now it's almost a oversaturation of it to where I'm telling people to get noticed now, use snail mail because no one gets any anymore. And if they get a package in the mail, they're going to pay attention to that, but they're not going to look at a link. They're not going to look at your email. So many people hide behind it sometimes. Mm-hmm. So I almost felt like a criminal. How do I get out of jail? Not that Huntington was jail, but how do I, no one was publishing comics here. How do I get out of that and do what I've been wanting to do since I was 6 years old? And that was always my motivation, was getting to do what I wanted to do as a kid.
Well, see, and that seems to be that dead-end mindset that people have. Like, if you are in Huntington, West Virginia, like, how do I get out of here? They don't see these people that have done amazing things just like you that are from here. And you're not just a Huntington, West Virginia native. You are actually a Marshall J School alum.
Well, now, I want to correct that part because I have tried and tried so many times, but people have either glossed over it. I did not graduate. I went 3.5 years in journalism, and in that 3.5, that half year, I got engaged for the first time. And head over heels, it was something like out of a Hallmark movie. It was wonderful. And the next thing I knew, I said, well, I'll work a little more, because I was working at Davidson's Record Shop downtown Huntington, which was a great job to have in college. And next thing I knew, that time went on, and I think I am a semester or two semesters from it, but never did, the career went on after that, marriage and kids and stuff. but I just always wanted to make, never quite made it over the hump, which drives me crazy, but you know, hey, I've still got time, I guess. I could always
come
back.
That's true. I mean, you are welcome to come join us. You did tour the facilities today.
True, so. True. But I did want to make that clear. I didn't want anyone to think I was claiming something that I did not achieve. So that was so close, though.
It happens to a lot of people.
True.
And that doesn't mean, I mean, clearly you have been very successful regardless.
It's worked out not only on the creative side, but on the marketing side. It worked out to be vice president of marketing for at least 6 major comic book publishers. It has worked out. It was one of those things on the job. Can you mm-hmm. do it? Yes, you can, and continue to do it. And that's worked out extremely well. So, you know, so I'm a happy boy.
Then you can't complain.
No,
it's the best
no,
way to
I never
be in
do.
Life.
No.
I do want to ask, though, the time that you were here, were there any lessons that really stuck with you during the rest of your career that you took from the world of journalism that you have utilized?
Oh, definitely. I mentioned this earlier before we got on the air. Ralph Turner mm-hmm. was such an influence for me and a great guy as far as directing me in the right direction. And back then, in the 70s, to be a writer, they said you got to write for a newspaper, a magazine, that sort of thing. And so I thought, well, this is, you know, where I go, even though I want to make stories up, I want to do fiction. And at one point, it was great because he was so observant, and there were a lot in our class. And he told me, he goes, Beau, he goes, we deal in facts in journalism. And he goes, your stories, they're humorous, they're creative, they're great, but they're not facts completely. And he goes, you need to really go towards the creative writing side. And he did a lot of extra stuff of finding out who here I needed to talk to and where I needed to go to do that, which was like a light switch going on for me, because I felt, even though I enjoyed journalism and I learned a lot from journalism, which I yell at the TV today, sometimes in the papers when I read them, but it helped me out. And he was one of the first people back then to put me on the path that I needed to be on. And it worked out wonderfully and gave me, at a time of my life in 87, when I got actually said, I'm going to have to make a stab at writing comics and doing what I want. That was part of what drew it to me, because to be honest with you, in 86, I was working at a pretty much a dead-end job. It was not going to go any further. I was divorced from my first wife. I was not living with my son, who was just, you know, 3 then. And I'll never forget, I was sitting on the tailgate of my pickup truck in the parking lot after work one night, and I said, this is not what I want to do. This is not it. And I've always wanted to write comic books and to create stories, to tell stories for other people. So I decided then that's when I was going to make a run at it. And my girlfriend, who has been my wife now for 37 years, was wonderful. She was the second person that said, you've always wanted to do this, do it. What do you got to figure out what to do, and we'll do it. So I did all my little back things of signing. I would write letters in to the editors. I would buy, let's say I bought 6 comics that week. I would, as soon as I got them, read them, I would write letters to each one of those comics, letters of criticism, because they had letter pages then. And I would sign my full name, Stephen Scott Beau Smith. First thing, that sets me apart from everybody else that's writing letters. They're signing Bill Dawson, John Doe, whatever. I tried to make each letter a story about that comic. I would try to be humorous. I would try to be constructive criticism, the things that they wanted. And if I could, I would throw little marketing tips in on that. Well, I ended up getting probably about 300 letters printed in those. The editors got to know me, the assistant editors got to know me. So when I would go to one of these conventions, I'd introduce myself to one of the editors. You're the guy with 4 names. Yeah, I know you, and you're from that little town in West Virginia. They think every town in West Virginia is little, which I would educate them upon that, that they weren't. So that started out, because then they would send me advance copies in Xerox form. We want to do a new comic, but we want to have a letters page. Would you write a letter for us ahead of time? Sure. And then after a while, rapport was built up, And they would ask, have you ever thought about pitching stories? I said, yeah, sure I have. That started the whole thing. And in 87, Eclipse Comics at the time needed a sales manager and marketing guy for, and they were in Santa Rosa, California. I said, I can do that as long as I don't have to move there. Because to be honest with you, mine never was a case of wanting to get out of Huntington. I love Huntington. I love West Virginia. Where else can I go to pick up my mail? And they go, Beau, you got Spider-Man on the front of an envelope. You know, that is means a lot to me. So I did that. I was able to do it remote with just fax machine and the phone at that time. Worked out extremely well. Got to stay here. Now, granted, I did have to travel 2 weeks out of every month, but that was fun traveling. That was going to all these different places doing retail and creative seminars with all of our distributors and our retailers. So that was wonderful. I mean, you know, you'd go, you would talk to, you know, I'd be doing a seminar, I'd be talking to 2,500 people at a time. And then I'd come back here and, you know, it's home. It was a complete decompression of, oh, I get to relax, you know, I'm home. But that's actually what did it. And I just kept doing those things. And like I said earlier, you get me talking, it's diarrhea of the mouth. I go on and on. But that's kind of how I inched into the business.
Do you think that that would have been possible had you not had a support system such as your now wife or a mentor like Turner?
Oh, that was in the 70s, especially even in the 60s when I used to tell my elementary school teachers, I want to write comic books. They were just like, they'll rot your brain, you know, that kind of, and they, I wish we would have had more. And that's why when I talk to schools, I talk to groups, you know, any chance I usually get, I even get people, they'll go, my son's interested. And they'll go, well, let's have lunch with him and I'll talk to him. You know, I mean, it's something I want to do and pay back to the people that did it for me. And back then that wasn't. Nowadays, I mean, you know, just going through here and getting a tour of everything and how much it's changed since then, this is what I love seeing. This is just beyond what I ever thought it could be. And I am thrilled. I talked to some of the college kids. Our church is predominantly Marshall students. And they will say, oh, I got a graphic novel class. I've got this. And I thought, my head was going to explode because I never thought that would ever happen. You know, they're teaching you how to write comics. This is wonderful. So I am thrilled beyond belief that not my legacy per se, but the legacy of writing, being creative, comic books in my case, television, video games, which I've done that, are going to continue and go far beyond anything I ever dreamed of.
Speaking of things you've worked on, I do want to talk a little bit about the comics that you've brought in today, because I want to ask you about any future projects that you have under your belt.
Well, with Wynonna Earp, which I created that actually when I was in sixth grade. I used to write, instead of doing my arithmetic, which I flunked and had to take in summer school, because I was writing stories about Wyatt Earp and his brothers fighting the universal monsters, Frankenstein, Dracula, Wolfman, Creature from the Black Lagoon. And this was in 1966. And that was one of these continuing storylines that I was always concerned with and always up for. So in 19, we'll fast forward to 1996, I said, how can I bring this, you know, we had pitch meetings, and I said, how can I bring this today? Well, Westerns weren't big in 96, so I said, I'm gonna have to make this a modern day Western. We'll make her a U.S. Marshal like he was. And that was the other thing, was the gender turn. Instead of a great-great-grandson, which most people, because I had to go, what would most people do? They'd do a grandson. Well, I'm going to do a granddaughter. And instead of witness protection program, honey, trace skippers, and anyone that's committed crime, like a normal marshal, she's going to do it in the supernatural world. So if monsters, if a wolfman needs to be put in witness protection program, then she's going to do that. If vampires are selling illicit drugs in the Southwest, well, she's going to stop that. So she is a supernatural marshal in that aspect. So that was quirky enough to happen. But one thing I told the editors and the publisher, I said, this is a must. It has to be, there has to be humor, heart, as well as action in this. And I said, a sense of family, which I have all that. I mean, it's, and I always wrote her at 40, 45 at the top of her game in the U.S. Marshals. So we were optioned as a television series twice before, and one time it came down to Joss Whedon with Dollhouse, J.J. Abrams with Fringe, and they optioned Wynonna Earp. Well, J.J. Abrams, Joss Whedon, Beau Smith. Okay, we'll get these two done first, which they did, and they were TV series on Fox. And I was the second one, and that was when the strike and a new regime came in, and mine just didn't make it. We just, that far. But I was used to that. You know, that happens. So a few years later, Sci-Fi Network said, you know, I get a call from the publisher. They're interested in Wynonna Earp as a TV series. And I'm going, okay, you know, let me know when it gets serious, because I'd been through this before. And Ted Adams, who was the CEO of IDW Publishing, where I was working, and also where Wynonna Earp was published, he believed in the book since 96. I mean, he's the third in the trilogy of people that supported and backed me. He said, from day one, he said, this needs to be a TV series. This has got everything it needs to be a hit TV series. And I was, thanks, I appreciate that. But he kept on it, and all of a sudden, everything was going week by week. It was getting faster and faster. Emily Andrus, the showrunner and head writer on the television series, sent me Wynonna Earp Bible and the script to a pilot. And I looked at it and read it, and I sat on it for a whole weekend. Got to be honest with you, and that was 60 then. I'm 69 now. If I would have been 25, 30, I would have gone, yes, let's do it. But this, I wanted to wait, you know, and because this usually doesn't happen to somebody that's been in the business as long as I have in my age. So I waited, and I kept thinking, I've taken it as far as I can in the comics industry for 30 years at that point. And my male target audience then were males 15 to 55, which I had. But she could take this into television and do what she knows and what she's trained to do in her medium. And she goes, let's turn it over, Beau. Let's have her at the beginning of her career when she is a total wreck and doesn't know what she's doing and how she built up to be what you've been writing all these years. And I said, that sounds great. I had two very small changes that I made. Other than that, I said, to get to a bigger level of more eyeballs on this, I need to let them do what they're going to do. So we did that, and within, I'd say, by the half season point of season one, I always like to put it this way, I handed Emily Andrus a loaf of bread, and she made sandwiches for the world, because it became a huge hit with females 15 to 55, which did nothing but add that to mine, and all of a sudden they're discovering not only the television show, but the comic books as well, because we were giving them both versions and different versions of it. And it was beyond my wildest dreams of anything like that happening. And every season I kept saying, well, maybe we'll get a second season. Maybe we'll see. Second season came. Third season came. I mean, it was just fourth season came. And we'd go every year to San Diego Comic Con and have a, that was where it was always announced we're either going to have it or not. Mm-hmm. And it was neat every year to have that. So recently, in fact, last week we just finished wrapping up production of the new Wynonna Earp special, which will be a two-hour special on Tubi. It'll be streamed on Tubi. So that is done. A couple of cast members came down to the house in December, and we talked about it, and we were eating at all the local eateries here that I frequent, places like Central City and Holy Smokes down in Cerrito and stuff, and they just, Beau, you got to take us to these diners that you always see you eating at. So they got a taste of West Virginia, and they bought Marshall shirts while they were in, and they're all, ours is a Canadian production and all Canadian cast, so they were, no one else is going to have this up there. You know, they were all thrilled. My wife and I like to say that with the cast and the crew, we've got three sons, but now we've got a whole family, because the cliche of Canadians being so nice is 100% true. For the last 8 years, we have got a whole new family, and I've got to co-write. I brought Tim Rozon and Melanie Scrofano, who plays Wynonna, into the comics. We have co-written comics together, got them to know, because that's part of my legacy of they can continue this. You know, if I decide just to retire one day, which I doubt if I will, but, you know, they'll be able to carry that on as well. So, and Tim and I are doing a separate book. Melanie and I are doing a separate book on new characters that we've created. So it's just that continual creativity has been a blast for me.
And I will mention, since you're talking about bringing them into the comic book world as well to create new books, you were talking about incorporating yourself.
Yes. the ultimate ego, that's me. When I was a kid, I was the only one that, and to be honest, what ego wasn't attached to it. It's just, I heard this saying when I was in elementary school, like sixth grade, write about what you know about. Well, I know about me. So I always wrote me in as a character just because that's what I knew. Growing up, there was a favorite cartoon show that was on primetime for me. It was called Johnny Quest. And Johnny Quest was supposed to be about my age. And I always thought, man, to be a kid like that, you're on all these adventures, your dad lets you shoot machine guns at bad guys and things. I just thought that was the ultimate. And so that I kind of put myself in that place and continued to do that in Winona Earp. Smitty is the head of the Black Badge division in the comic books. So he's the seasoned hand that kind of mentors Winona through a lot of stuff. And he's there for a little comedy relief sometimes because his pop culture references are a little dated. So like someone else I know. So that was done. And besides, if you cannot own your own likeness, what's the advantage, you know? I've constantly, in my comics, I've put Marshall, I've put West Virginia, I've put Cerrito, I've put my family and friends in as characters throughout my 37-year career. In fact, my very first comic, I put almost everybody, including my insurance agent at the time, I put him in there as the bad guy, just so everyone could get, I said, they're never going to let me do a comic book after, you know, after this, and I wanted to get everyone in that one time. Clint McElroy, a local guy, he and I went through Marshall together. We were in the journalism program together and stuff. We're still best friends today and done all the stuff. I had him in there. Chuck Minsker, who worked at, it was WHTN, it was WOWK. I had everybody in there. And it was just insanity and fun, mirth and mayhem. And, you know, do it while you can. You never know when they're going to take it away from you. So I did.
And that's one thing that you can't do in journalism is you can't have yourself in the story.
Right.
So it's so much fun to be able to say, like, you still took the lessons that you learned and were able to incorporate them while still putting yourself, your legacy, the people that you know and love, the things that you have learned about your home, yeah, and incorporate them into your work.
And again, I cannot give enough credit to Dr. Turner there was a, you know, good-sized class, and he could see, not just don't do that anymore, stick to the facts, like a lot of people would. Where can I place you, Beau, to where you're going to thrive on what you do best? And that seriously, you know, I'm sure wouldn't remember or anything like, but that seriously made me thrive. I mean, that was, he cares enough to put me in the right room, to put me in the right direction. And I have, again, always tried to do that because there were a lot of people, I was naive when I was breaking into the comics, that I would write other writers and artists going, hey, what's a script look like? What's this? And Robert Kandiger, who invented Sergeant Rock, Walt Simonson, famous from the Thor comics, Mike Baron, who did Nexus, The Badger, The Punisher. These guys didn't know me from squat, but I wrote them letters, and they took the time to, this is what a plot looks like. This is what editors like. They did not have to take that time, but they did. And I have continued to do that to this day. We just did that at Lexington Convention in Lexington, Kentucky. And my bright spot's looking at artists' portfolios, people, I'm going to be a writer. This is kind of, you know, getting as many tips as I can in that short amount of time, but just that encouragement to where they'll do it, because I want to see comic books, I want to see writing, I want to see all this stuff thrive. And it was neat that I got to talk to journalism students down there that said, well, you know, journalism is what I want to report. I want to do investigative reporting. I want to keep in touch with my community, make sure people always know that if I'm working for a community newspaper that they're going to, you know, that they can get the truth. And I thanked them because, I mean, it's almost like thanking someone for being in the military and doing their service. I'm so glad to see in journalism that there are still people that want to get the truth out, and as plain of, it's not about them, it's about the story, the who, what, where, when. And I know it may even sound corny, I'm sorry, but that thrills me to death to see that. It really does.
Well, would you say it's more important now than ever because journalism is ever adapting? And we were just talking before the interview about how much has changed and expanded and how many more mediums are available. Yeah. Is it more important than ever to figure out exactly what your niche is early on?
Oh, I think so, definitely. And especially just to continue to talk a little bit about journalism in journalism, because as you all well know, technology is changing so fast. And when it changes quick like that, it's like a lawless frontier occasionally. The rules haven't been set. And sometimes ethically and morally, that gets a little left behind because we're running so fast to get this done. And I really, again, hats off to those that can use technology in the right way to get the truth and factual reporting and feature articles. I mean, that's... I was feeling like that was a lost art for a while, and recently I'm seeing and reading more and more good feature articles about things I'm interested in, things I don't know anything about, but now I'm interested in, and I was so thrilled to see that. So, but, you know, technology, if I would have had the internet and social media when I was starting to break into comics, I would have been intoxicated with that power of being able to have all this at my fingertips. I used to have for reference for stories, like in all of my books, I do a lot of reference, and I used to have to go to the library, to the card catalog, the whole thing, and now it's at my fingertips, and it's just mind-boggling. And I love it that I've lived long enough to see that, and possibly some more that, you know, that's coming. I mean, that's wonderful.
What's one piece of advice that you would give to any student, regardless of major, about trying to figure out what their niche is?
I'll give you an anecdote that kind of falls along in the lines. I was doing a talk at an elementary school, I guess about 15 years ago. And I was telling them, I said, always find something you're interested in as a job. And I said, you'll study for that in school. Look for things that will lead. I said, I asked one kid, I said, what do you want to be? And he says, I want to be a professional baseball player. And we've all said that in an elementary age. I said, to get into that, you're going to have to be really special and talented. And I said, and not that many people. You look, there's nine guys on a team, you know, that kind of thing. How are you going to do that? And I said, if you don't, I said, you can't be disappointed and just, well, okay, I'll do anything, and end up at a job that you don't want to do or work that you're not crazy about. I said, find out how to be in that business. You're still in baseball, but I said, you know, there are people that are, there's coaches, you can do that. There's all kinds of different things. I said, you can work in offices. There's so much related to that. And, you know, you never know what sticks and what doesn't. It went on and on. Well, ends up, you know, 15, 20 years later, I ran into that gentleman now. He's a grown man. And he was the head equipment manager for the Diamondbacks in Arizona because he said, he goes, I got into it. He goes, I knew I was going to do too good. You know, baseball, I did all right. But he started going, well, you know, can I start out, I think, as a ball boy for somebody? And then that, making the connections, just like I did in comics. And he was doing his life's work, you know, love. He was working in a business, so many in video games now. Everybody, I love to play video games. And this is back before that happened. And I told them, I said, fine, be a part of that. You may not be writing them, but you may be reviewing them. You may be doing the marketing. You may be in the office. There's just all kinds of things you can be a part of, whatever it is you love. Most of mine end up being creative related, but it's true with, you know, somebody, a kid loves to put puzzles together. That's a born accountant to me right there, because they're going to be able to put those number puzzles together and enjoy it. I get no satisfaction out of that, but they would. And it's finding something you love, then finding a way to get paid to do it. And, you know, what's the other cliche? You never work at something you love. And that's you know, it changed my life from being slammed up against the wall doing dead-end jobs, having a low point, to everything far beyond my expectations. And still getting to live here.
So you've talked a lot about, you know, having that support system and a mentor that really helps you figure out what you want to do. It's what makes or breaks your success. But you've also talked a lot about accountability with yourself, about what you need to do to take those steps to make sure you're successful and find what you enjoy. And a lot of times, especially with students, they'll get into that mindset that the cards are stacked against me, like I can't possibly get anywhere. How do you battle against that?
It is tough, and it does break down with each individual's mindset as well. With me, I can only say that it was a case of I wanted something so bad. I wanted to tell stories so badly. It was just something that I was gravitated to at the age of 4. I couldn't read comics, but I saw those amazing pictures, and I saw word balloons. I knew they were saying something. Couldn't read them at that point, but I was wanting to know, what was it? And to this day, I can't explain the attraction between static words and pictures, but it's encouragement from others. It's a support system. And it's, in my case, it was finding people that didn't think I was crazy and, you know, wanted to do something creative. And I use myself not as an example. Small town, West Virginia, everything was New York. I did it. If I can do that, especially with all the tools that are available today, and a lot of it is getting to know people, talking to people. I bug people in the terminals of the airport. What kind of job you got? And I love to hear about everybody's job. I think that's fascinating. I don't read fiction. I read nonfiction because what I do with nonfiction, I put my skew on it and make it something fictitious, just like Dr. Turner saw back then. You're taking facts, but you're making something wonderful and creative. It's just not what we need in the newspaper. And I can't stress, people think they're hobbies. You can make that into your livelihood as well, or your interest, let's put it that way. And I hate to see creativity and desire stifled because someone didn't talk to somebody enough. But making connections, having rapport with people sometimes that you don't even know I've never had a problem with, like I said, when I did seminars and I do speeches and stuff with these things, of getting in front of an audience. If it doesn't work out, I'm the only person that, well, I guess they didn't like it. You got to be able to let that roll off. I've got a box of rejection letters when I first started submitting stories that's huge. I got them all the time. Everybody, I wouldn't do it anymore. No, I'll get 300 or 400. I don't care. Somebody at one point is going to go, give this guy a job so he'll quit writing, or they'll actually read what I've got. You can't let that bother you. You can't. You can't take it personal because it is. And writing is harder. An artist, I can look at someone's art and tell you, yeah, you're good enough, or you're going to be good enough, or unfortunately, you're really going to have to work hard to be able to do it. But with writing, 9 times out of 10, an editor, and unfortunately, is just going to toss it because they get so many. They've got writers under contract, and they like to bring in people they find themselves, not solicited. So even though that's a hard truth about it, you can't let that stop you. You just can't. If you're a real writer, you're going to write regardless, even if it's for your own. I tell people, I said, write for your own satisfaction. Write 15 minutes a day. If that's all you've got, write 15 minutes. Something's going to happen at some point, and share it. You know, share it with other people. That keeps your spirits up as well. Not people glad-handing you and say, hey, that's good, because most of the time these days they're going to tell you, hey, I could use this. But always share it with somebody because they're going to pick something up that you didn't see. Editors are so important in that fact, truly trained editors, because they can save you from looking like a moron sometimes with stories, because I'm so close to my stories. I know what's going on in my head, but I forget sometimes the reader might not, and the editor who's on the outside will catch that and adjust this, adjust that. It's a lifesaver.
It's actually funny because you're talking about learning to take in criticism and not let it defeat you and roll with the punches as life goes on. That's actually a lot like Winona.
Well, she was based on my mother and my grandmother. My grandmother was a saint, and my mom was the saltiest side of a female sailor you ever saw. And she is truly a combination of both of them. And that was one of the things I told Emily when they were doing it. I said, there's got to be a sense of family and humor. I said, there's got, and Emily nailed that. I mean, Winona, and to be honest with you, of the 300 auditions we had for Winona Earp, when I was looking through that, Melanie was in my top three, and I didn't have them in any order. She, when she and I write, I feel like I, when I get the scripts in from her, I've got to put on adult diapers because I'm going to use the bathroom in my pants because she's so funny. I mean, she is quick-witted and it's smart, and it's, It's a neat, it's Christmas time when the computer comes on.
She's an absolute joy to watch on screen.
She's a very good, she can play anything. She's a great director. She's a mother of two boys. I mean, she's a number one. She really is. And I got to tell you, Tim Rozon, who I co-write a lot with, plays Doc Holliday. You will not find a more selfless person than that guy. I mean, he's young enough to be my son, but yet there's many times when I'm frustrated, something's going on, I kind of ask myself, well, Tim wouldn't do that, so I'm not going to be. I mean, he's encouraged and lifted me up a little bit just by the way he treats people and goes about business and stuff. They're a great bunch of people, and very thankful we've gotten to know all of them.
Now, even though you chose to do kind of like the gender bend role for Winona.
Yeah.
You still chose to include Doc Holliday.
Well, that credit goes to Emily. Emily wanted to bring in part of the Wyatt Earp history because I did not have Doc in the original comics before the television series. And that was a stroke of genius on her part to add the history shows. We're going to get some people that watch this show, they're going to know the name Earp. Well, okay, I'll watch it for that. But if they know that, they're going to expect Doc Holliday. And she wanted to give them Doc Holliday. And it was a brilliant, brilliant move on her part. And he and Winona have ended up being this cult classic couple of fantasy, science fiction, and action. And the stuff in the special is just going to make people go, because this picks up a little later after season four. So people are going to, I can't say anything because Emily will come to my house and hit me in the head, but it's going to be amazing what she's done.
I'm excited to tune in.
It just really, she turns everything on its head. It's going to be neat.
Well, I'll definitely be tuning in for that.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that.
Oh, my gosh. Now, I want to back up a little bit.
Yes, ma'am.
Because we are talking about Winona being such a spitfire. Do you think that kind of personality would serve people well when they are trying to make a name for themselves in any career?
Yes, and I've said this before, you have to market yourself and not be afraid to, because a lot of people are, whether they're socially awkward or just shy, to be honest, I'm an introvert, I really am, and I just find when I get excited about something I like, I can turn the volume up and share what's inside, and Winona Earp is a perfect example of, I mean, you look at that first season, she's not real tolerant of a lot of people. And she's prejudiced against all revenants and all monsters. And she, in the series, and then I did it in issue 8, where she learns not all of them are bad. I need to talk to them, listen to them. So she adds that spitfire part with a little more compassion. And she continues to grow from season 1 through 4. And that's really important to make a character. It's my number one concern when I'm doing any book with any character, good guy, bad guy, whatever, there's got to be, and a bad guy, there's got to be an ounce of likability or relatability, and there has to be with the character, because if they're not, then the reader's not going to have any emotional investment, and they're going to care who lives, who dies, what happens. The conflict's dime a dozen. Anybody can do it. It's like superpowers. You can do anything you want. They've all been done, redone, but likability hasn't. If you were to read a comic book or a graphic novel and you can't really relate to the character or like them, then something's wrong. 9 times out of 10, you're not going to pick up another one. Same way with a television show. I've watched some TV shows where I went, okay, why don't I want to watch this again? Well, I don't care about anybody. Back in the day, I think it was 2004, I got, by accident, I stumbled across Lost on television, and I was hooked because that was in a big ensemble cast. I cared about every character, good and bad, in there, wanted to know more. That was brilliantly done. And even at midpoint in my career at that point, I said, I want to even continue to emulate that, where they care about every minor character, sub-minor, you know, whatever. And I was lucky with DC Comics doing Guy Gardner, one of the Green Lanterns in the 90s, 2.5 years, that they gave me the freedom to do that with iconic characters I did not own. And I got to borrow Wonder Woman, Superman, Wonder Woman in different ones, and how they relate to Guy Gardner, who was just as regular as dirt, kind of a superhero. And I had the time of my life. I mean, now everything's larger corporation owned, so it's harder to do. But there was such freedom then, and you could do... I mean, I told my editor, they go, well, why do you want to do this Wonder Woman? Because I did Wonder Woman Meets Xena as a Elseworlds prestige book. And why do you want to do it? I said, I want the readers to know what's on her iPod. He goes, what do you mean? I said, I want them to know her. I said, she's been around for almost 80 years. Does anybody know her? I said, if you know your friend, you know what music they like. I said, I want her to be an iconic character, but one you can relate to at the same time. So he goes, yeah, write it up. You know, so got to do that, which was a thrill of mine, because I read Wonder Woman as a kid. Most little boys in the 60s, that's a girl's comic. I'm not going to read that. That's what they do. I thought, this is a great character. Aquaman was another one. Everybody, oh, he's the most boring character back then. I wanted to make him fun. I wanted to make it, you know. And that was part of my ways then. I read comics and enjoyed them, but I always had ideas of how can I make this better? And that was the storytelling thing is an addiction, and it's hard to get out of your system. And that's why I tell everybody they need to write every day just to get it out. And I'm sure you asked the original question. I hope I answered it. I went off on my tangent.
You did. You may have given me a couple dozen more, but that's okay. I'll go back to one specifically. You're talking about connections.
Yeah.
I do have to know. I know we were talking about it earlier, but in every bit of work that you've ever done, what are some of your favorite Huntington Easter eggs that you have placed in your work?
Third issue of Wine on Earp had it all take place in Wayne County. It was out Wayne in a bar called The Drain, and I had a character that spoke like an academic, almost Shakespearean. In fact, I did it on purpose because Stan Lee used to do this in comics when I was a kid. I made this so the reader would have to look up half the words he said. And at that point, I already knew I was going to bring Smitty in, issue 8. And this was 3. So I had him, and he's from West Virginia, Wayne County. I had him look just like me, which is the thing, because he ends up being the evil cousin of Smitty. And there's a tie-in that goes in further. But I had the best time because it all took place in Huntington, West Virginia. The first comic story I did, Dogs of Danger, my family, that's the one my family, friends, everyone was in. It all took place in Huntington, took place at Camden Park for the big climactic battle. I put all that in Winona Earp, the Yeti Wars. I couldn't believe no one had ever did Yetis versus Bigfoot, ever. In movies, anything, no one. So I did that in this, and the Bigfoot, the Yetis were communists too, they were Russian. So we had that, which was, a twist on that. But Smitty wore a Marshall letter jacket the entire time. And, you know, that's where he always says, I'm from Marshall, and makes Thundering Herd references. Those are the fun things that you get to do. And for me, I got to be honest, when I got into comics, there weren't a lot of people that they say I have an accent, but, you know, where are you from? Texas? And I go, oh, no, sir. I'm from West Virginia. Well, I've been to Richmond. You know, give them that. But that I got to educate people on Huntington, Cerrito, where I've lived for the last 30 years. I've gotten to educate them on this state and Marshall University. And We Are Marshall helped out a whole lot for me as a tool, because they're going, Beau, you got me a Marshall hat one time. This is the same. I said, there you go. Because that's one of the gifts that I hit the gift shop and in Glenn's, and I'm always sending people out of town. The cast all have Marshall stuff. I mean, that's what I always do, just to get the word out there, because that's what they'll go, this is Marshall, and it's in Huntington, West Virginia. It's free, it's a platform, why not, you know? And it's something that makes people smile instead of, you know, not. And I tease my wife a lot of times that I want to get a shirt that says hashtag joy giver, because that's, and you can do that or your hashtag soul crusher, one of the two, and I don't want to be that. But it's just, it's fun getting, you know, I grew up, people made fun of West Virginia. I mean, it was a lot of, you know, the cliches, this and that. I said, it's not like it. I said, you really don't know the state. And it has seriously been my pleasure to do that, because that's a blast. I mean, I looked at I did the ancestry thing, and all my family, they came from Sweden, Denmark, Wales, you know, all the usual mix over there. I think there was 5% Portugal in one, but that was as exotic as it got. But they all came to this area and then never left. Once they came over from whatever country, they were in this area and they never left, which is, that says something to me about my family. Good, bad, you take it. But, you know, I'm the only one in my family. Both my brothers live in North Carolina, sister in Texas, cousins North Carolina. I've stayed here, and I love it here. I like it.
See, and I think that's one of the misconceptions, too, when we were talking about it at the very beginning of your interview, is when you were talking more about how much you love it here, and you've been successful. People think you need to leave to be successful, or that once you're successful, like, you don't come back and you kind of lose that space with your roots. But you have created an entire franchise for yourself, and you've stayed true to where you came from.
Now, you know, again, with technology, you can. I tell a lot of the freelancers and a lot of people, I said, cost of living in West Virginia is inexpensive compared to where you're at there. I said, this would be a wonderful place for publishing, for entertainment, I've always thought that more films should be made in West Virginia. You know, I don't know what the tax breaks and this, that. That's why we film in Calgary in Canada. There was the movie The Revenant that Leonardo DiCaprio did. We have that production crew because we went there. They said, if you come here, and that makes our show, which is a low budget show, look so much more expensive because of that crew in that location. And West Virginia could be that easily for the film industry. We've seen how much Wilmington, North Carolina, and Atlanta, Georgia have grown in the film industry from that, and West Virginia could do that. I really believe that. I'm not a politician or a bill maker or anything, but that's something people should look into.
Do you think that staying here has allowed you to explore more in terms of creativity than if you had gone elsewhere to, like, L.A. or anywhere like that?
I think so, because not being slammed by a lot of cultural stuff at once. When I started traveling 37 years ago when I worked for comics, I got to travel everywhere and see that, experience that, luckily enough, at an adult age where I could really appreciate it. I've done more self-education in the last 37 years than I can remember. And I've gotten an education from that, and I think more people could do that as well. It's you know, it's a wonderful state. You know, if you were looking for quiet too, I mean, most writers are, and culturally we're getting more and more of that all the time. And that's one thing I would like to see. You know, if it was up to me, there'd be a bookstore on every corner. There'd be theaters that just show this and that, and I'm into that, but I'm a lucky man.
Well, speaking of the reasons that you are lucky, I do want to know, outside of Winona Earp, and obviously DC, which I'm also a very large DC fan, if I didn't state that before.
Glad to hear that.
What is a project that you are particularly proud of that maybe has not received the same amount of attention?
Well, 1989-90, I came up with a story, and Chuck Dixon, who is a very well-noted writer, especially at DC. He's the co-creator of the character Bane in the Batman books. Chuck and I have been good friends since for 40 years. And we came up with a Golden Age character that was in public domain called the Black Terror. And that was my dad's favorite comic book when he was a kid. I asked him, of course, as a kid, why was your favorite comic book, Dad? Oh, the Black Terror. He wore a skull and crossbones, and he beat bad guys up, and that kind of a thing. So Chuck and I wanted to do that, but we wanted to turn it on its head. And, are you familiar with The Watchmen?
Yes.
And Neil Gaiman's work? And there's a lot of books that are looked at as deep and serious. Frank Miller's, Dark Knight, things like that. Chuck and I wanted to show that you could do that and still not make it so highbrow that you became pretentious, which I'm sure I could be if I knew, could spell it. But we did the Black Terror, and it was a straight, yes, he wore costumes, but it was a straight crime story, and historically, we shifted things. The Kennedys were the Capones. The Capones were the Kennedys in this other time thing. And it was all about crime and corruption. And even though the Black Terror was the cause, he worked for the Department of Agriculture as a dark agent. That's what he did. And that's a three-issue prestige series, crime story. Eclipse Comics published it. And that's one of them I can tell you. If you haven't read it, do. I think you would be surprised at the depth and you would say this is a movie. And the book was painted. Each page was painted by Dan Brereton, who's gone on to do so much stuff for every publisher there is. He won a Russ Manning Award for doing that book. And he painted every page. It was a real painting, big, large. And back then he was young and just starting out of art school. And he could paint a page a day back then, which is just, when you look at the art, it's just amazing. So that is one of my, I'll call it an unearthed gem that I will put that up against any book that's been done in comics in the last 40 years. And again, I don't have an ego, don't need it stroked. I always tell my wife, I can look in the mirror and get my ego stroked, and she says, oh, you're terrible, you're awful. But I really don't. I'm getting to do comics. That's the biggest thrill that I get. And I would say definitely that. My Guy Gardner run at DC was a perfect match for me of getting to do a comic book that was fun, that was a little irreverent sometimes, but straight superhero at the same time. So yeah, I've gotten to do, those are just a few. I mean, I've done hundreds, but those, and that's good, because that one's a creator owned and the other one's not. Wynonna Earp, I didn't even mention, because that's like a son or a daughter to me. So I can't really, that'd be cheating if I said that. But there's just been, what's my favorite? The next one I'm doing, Everybody, you go have more Wynonna Earp? I said, yes, more Wynonna Earp, but I'm trying to create the next fun thing that everybody will like. Hashtag joy giver,
You've mentioned your wife a couple times.
Yep.
So I want to know a little bit more about your personal life.
Well, Beth and I met, it'll be 38 years. We'll be married 38 years. And I got to tell you, she's like nobody I ever met. And when I did, back in my dating days, 60s, 70s, all that stuff, everybody dated a lot. And it was great and fun. But what attracted me, other than, her being out of my league, was she was always supportive, and where she doesn't know a stranger. You meet Beth, and you know her. I mean, she will, she's following you on Facebook 10 minutes later. I mean, she's everybody's friend. She loves everybody. She genuinely loves people. And I told you, I'm an introvert. I'm a little, we're going to see how you work out before I invite you, over to my house to do something, or we go out to, it's just a thing. And she is raised my level of trust with people, and I like to say I've kept her from being gullible with, you know, oh, this guy from Nigeria wants, he's a prince and he wants us to send him some money, let's do it. You know, I keep her from doing that stuff. So, but she is, she was married before and she had two sons. They were 8 and 9 when we got married. My son was 3, and I gave her a list. I said, here's all my bad traits. I said, you can check it with all my friends and family. I'm not afraid. If you think you're going to change a lot of these, you might, but it's doubtful these are things, because I was 32 then. I said, you know, check all those things. I don't know if she did or not. I don't think she did, but she should have. But I gave her that, and I told her, I said, as far as the boys go, and their father, you know, is alive and well. He's actually, we've become very good friends. I mean, he comes to our Thanksgiving, and I mean, anyway, it's weird. Other people think it's weird, but he and I are good buddies. He's a great guy. And I told her, I said, I'm going to treat these boys just like they're my own, no different than Nick. And Nick, Brad, and Dana, and I could not have written the script any better. They have been true brothers from day one, continue to be to this day. And it was never once, you're not my dad, I don't have to do that. None of that stuff. We had a blast. And it was all good. So, and now I'm trying to ruin the grandchildren, but Beth is riding herd on me on that. I told them, I said, when I croak, I want them to walk by the casket or the urn or whatever it may be and go, because they call me Bobo. Bobo was crazy. Oh, remember the time he said, that's all I want. I want to smile at them when they walk by the coffin. And Beth is just, I'm not kidding. She's like my grandmother I spoke of earlier. Beth's a saint. She genuinely really likes people. And it's a good lesson for me all the time to go, well, maybe this won't be so bad because I don't do too well in crowds where it's everyone's around you all the time. Give me a table in front of me, that's fine. But she's an inspiration and very, very supportive. She never once asked, well, will you make money in comic books? Is there any security? Is there? She goes, is this what you're wanting to do? Then let's do it right.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong, but you incorporated the name Bobo into your comic book series.
And Bobo Del Rey, the main bad guy, and which went into the television series as well. And the only inspiration that came from that name is so they would have to say my name twice. That was it. That was the whole, that's where the idea came from.
It's definitely a memorable name.
Oh, it was, it's fun. I just think, what sounds funny in my head? Hope it sounds funny when it comes out of my mouth. Beth tells me sometimes it's not. But, you know, that was the reason behind that. I get people, do you write out long drafts? Do you do this? No. It is, my writing is almost ad-libbed. I know where I'm going to take it and where it's going to go, but it's here, and I just write it. It's like there's things in me that have to come out. It's odd. I know it sounds like a nut. You all are probably going to be washing your hands and going, make sure he doesn't have an axe or anything. You know, that kind of, he's nuts. But I enjoy what I do.
That's good to hear. It really is. It's a breath of fresh air to see someone that is not drained by what they're doing. And no. You were talking about everything that you have accomplished, upcoming projects, how you're just excited for the next thing. So I do have to know, how do you recharge your battery?
I do spend a lot of time. I still read a book, two books a week. And like I said, they're all nonfiction. That, you know, just laying around. My dog and I take a hike every morning. I got a Swiss Mountain Dog mix, Cobb, who a comic book has been named after that I did. And that's another one of the undone gems. That he's a former Secret Service agent that helps and protects people. So that's another one I highly recommend. But doing that, my wife works, so she's at Marathon most of the day till about 3:30. So I've got every day at the house by myself with the dog, and that's my quiet time, and it works out really well. Then I get amped up when the grandkids are with us, and I get to poison their minds with stuff, or, you know, the boys are there and I harass them. But I get enough time by myself like that. Before this I had lunch with my best friend. We've been best friends, and I mean best friends, for 55 years. We, you know, have gone to school together all these years. He played football at Marshall back in our day, and and did great for me as a defensive end linebacker. And we have lunch still once a week, talk every day. And it's never about just the past. We talk about what's going to happen, what the future is and stuff. And there's you get somebody, especially with guys. his name's Ray Crabtree. Very supportive from we were kids. I mean, you know, yeah, I'll write that stuff down, you know. I'm sorry, I was losing my voice there. I wonder why. I've been lucky to have some supportive people here that have helped me write out there. But, yeah, I recharge that. Baseball season, I'm laying there watching the Cleveland Guardians in the evening. Beth and I do that. I know it sounds old and boring, but we get in bookstores. Oh, gosh. I go to a bookstore. I'm there for hours. And that's probably one of my very favorite things right there, especially when traveling.
I do want to talk a little bit about your overall creative philosophy. Storytelling in a few words, what you need to be able to be a good storyteller. What would you say that is?
Personally, it has to be something that I like and I enjoy. I've never, just for example, never done a whodunit because I have no interest in that. It reminds me too much of math to figure out all this. And God bless the people that are good at it and can do it. But I entertain myself first, and then I hope that it will entertain other readers, anybody that's reading it. And I always keep in mind, I want the soul of the story, the heart of the story to be in there, but I also want it, each page is a story. In a comic book, there's usually, let's say, 20 pages in a comic book. There's generally, I try not to go over 5 panels per page, because unless it's special occasion, it calls for it. 1 to 5 panels. And I want each one of those pages to be a turn, its own story. Each page is a first, second, and third act. And I've been doing it so long now, I automatically do it. But when I first started, I had post-its up, act 1, you know, these panels 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, just like that, to kind of remind me just of the template part of it. But it should be a beginning, middle, and end, even if it's a continued story. But in comic books, it's words and pictures. So there's a lot of words you're not going to have to use because you can do it with the pictures. I had a case where it was a Western that I was doing with another writer. And he had pages 1, 2, 3, three pages. But the first page went on. It was like 8 panels. And he goes, well, I just want to tell how this town was once beautiful, now it's destitute and it's corrupt and it's this, that, the other. And we sat there and talked, and we ended up breaking that down to 3 panels. And all it was showing the guy ride into town. And, yeah, you could show it with the buildings, what was once nice is not now. But the main thing it did, it was a dog walking across the street that you could see his ribs. You know, he was that, like the town, it was starved. So we ended up getting that in there without having to, because you don't want blocks of text that, you know, are like that in it. We might as well be writing prose then. And comic book scripting is its own craft. It is not screenwriting. It's not prose. It's not a screenplay. It's its own kind of writing because you are working with those pictures. And the artist can enhance a lot of stuff. I always write in full script. And I'll hand that in. He goes, Beau, I can change this 4-panel page. If you give me another panel, I can make this happen, and we can condense this and add this. And that does nothing but make the writer look smarter. And I love the collaboration, and they're able to do that. So it's the collaboration's a big part of someone, if they're going to write comic books, should do, because it makes it a team, but you learn at the same time. It's like we're talking about being on film set. You learn from the team, and it makes the book go a lot smoother and more cohesive, and it makes everybody look a lot smarter.
So it's definitely not a lonesome art form.
No, other than me writing in a room by myself, in the old days, I would be on the phone with the artist going back and forth. Now you text and it's, you got this, got the, yeah. And with certain, if I'm co-writing with Tim or somebody, we both have the final draft program so he can see it on the screen and make the changes same time I am. We can even do that on occasions, but most of the time it is by myself, writing alone, but I like that. I always, after I finish the script, I always read everything out loud. I'm all characters, I go through the whole thing, because what I think is brilliant when I put it on paper, if I say it out loud, ooh, gosh, that sounds awful or not right, and I can change that. But it can be lonely if you're a lonely person, I guess. I'm there with all those characters and what's going on, and I usually don't feel so lonely.
It's like a whole other world of your own.
Oh, it really is. And there's times where I just, okay, I'm stuck on this or I'm tired. That's when Cobb, let's get the leash, let's go, bud. And, you know, we're gone for an hour, come back. And a lot of my thoughts and storylines come when I'm taking a shower or walking the dog. And it's just, those are my key creative times.
That really hits home on the importance of recharging your battery.
Oh, yeah.
And I know, like, students especially, they think, like, I need to pull that all-nighter. I just need to, like, power through. And it's draining you more.
Yeah, 100%. I can see it doing it every once in a while on a really tight deadline where something's happened, somebody had to turn it. But if you can avoid it, you know, not procrastinate to where, you know, putting off to where you're... Because a lot of people like that adrenaline of that, but... Your best writing, at least for me, does not come out when there's a huge rush like that. My sometimes writing partner, Chuck Dixon, I mentioned earlier, he is generally 6 months ahead of schedule on all of his projects. He's had projects where the book got canceled and there were still four issues DC Comics had in their can because he'd already done them. And that's the way he's always worked for a couple reasons. He likes working that way. He's full of ideas. And also, they're less likely to fire you or to cancel the book if they've already paid for and it's sitting there in a can. And I think he broke the World Guinness Book of Records in the last year or so of, and I know there's a million of them, but for the most comic books, either comic book stories or comic book pages ever written.
Wow.
And he's to this day, because Chuck's my age, he is amazing and has not slowed down. If anything else, he's sped up. But he's an amazing example of, somebody says writer's block to him, writer block, he just laughs. I mean, he goes all the time. And his work is never mediocre. It's never, you know, somebody that writes that much must be, you know, mailing it in sometimes. Never. Ever. He is as excited as I am still about comics and stuff, and it's about comics. His new book is getting put into a film. Sylvester Stallone and Jason Statham are doing it based off his Levon Cade books. He's excited about that, but comics is what he's... Everybody, oh, you're going to write? No, I'm too busy writing comics. That's what he loves to do.
He's also excited about the next thing, just like you.
It's. I think it's something in you that's got to come out.
That's amazing to me to think about. And it really is. I feel like the busiest people are the ones that love their work the most.
Oh, it's hard. You summed it up pretty good right there. Cause there's never a day I just am not excited that 12-year-old Beau is still here going, I'm getting to write comics. And it's just something I love to do.
As we were even talking about it before we started your interview today, that it's never a dull day. There's always something new happening.
Yeah.
And that's what keeps it entertaining. It's what keeps you creative. It gets the juices flowing.
100%. It's like that's the oil in the joints right there. You saying it out loud reminds me, which I know it's running through my head, but I just think, yeah, I'm very, very blessed to be doing what I'm doing.
It really truly is. It's exciting for me to watch someone else be so excited about their work. Even after so many years and the success that you have seen, you are still excited, you are still learning, you're still growing, you're open to criticism, new opportunities. And that's important for younger generations to look at.
Yeah.
And especially like students nowadays, that's why we were talking about the importance of taking that in stride, going with the flow.
Yeah, and whether they're in for it for the success or the money or both or just doing it. Mine's always been the doing it part first, fame or success part of it. People can give you that for free, but it's also good to get paid. You know, that's, and I always tell everybody, I said at the beginning, you may do a couple of sample spec stuff, you know, but when it starts to become, whether it's, if you're doing work, you need to get paid like it's work. And a lot of people I know in my industry and in film for that will do stuff at the beginning and do it, well, I'm going to be in a movie, or I'm going to use this, and they're doing it for free, so to speak, or credit. And that's fine and dandy, but they get in a habit, and there's always somebody that's going to take advantage of that. Mm-hmm. And you know, not being awful towards people, but they will. They will take advantage of that, and you don't want to work for free, because you know, a person's time is always worth a lot, you know, regardless whether you love it or not. People are used to, well, I sell shoes, I'm just using that as an example, but you know, they want to get paid to do it. And you know, I do comics, but and editors even will know that you love doing what you do, or you love working on this character, and that will be the carrot sometime that's dangled over you to, you know, meet a crazy deadline or not get as much money as you regularly. Would you take a little cut on your contract on this? You gotta always be a business person at the same time. And once you start doing regular business, especially if it's creator owned, and a lot of people don't like to do it, have a lawyer look at a contract. If you get a contract, have somebody look that over, because a lot of people will just sign their name and all of a sudden they've signed their rights away forever for it. And there's always that lesson to be learned too.
All of that goes back to the accountability for your own success again. It's just as dependent on you as it is having that good support system.
100%.
And that's more and more people now than ever. That's something they really need to be reminded of.
People have, the accountability also has to come in with yourself with deadlines. You know, we were talking about that. You have to meet that deadline, you know, and the things come up, life comes up sometimes, but you know, you have understanding editors, but you should always look, know what your skill level is and desire level to where you can meet that deadline and be honest with yourself. Then you can be honest, you know, with your editor or whoever else needs, because in comics, there's an artist, sometimes an inker, a letterer, a colorist waiting for you to do yours so they can do theirs. They don't get paid until you get, you know, it to them. So a lot of people depend, not only your family, but your team depends on you getting the job done so that everybody gets paid and everybody gets happy.
Well, for students especially, deadlines importance. It's, you're not a student anymore. You know, it does not stop. Life continues. It's always busy. And I feel like students get in that mindset where they think they just need to get over the hump of school and then they'll hit a plateau. Is that true?
You know, I'm not using the geometry and algebra that I did, you know, in my job, but the deadlines, the life stuff that I learned while in high school, while at Marshall, is all there. I mean, things that certain teachers told me then did not come into effect till I was sometimes, you know, my 20s or 30s. All of a sudden, that is true. I do need to pay attention to this, to this, to this. And at that point, it becomes, well, they gave me a free tip. You know, you don't realize it, at least I didn't at 18, 19. But it's good teachers are invaluable, especially the ones that can make that connection, and you keep that connection as you become an adult. They have been for me. I always say I learned more after 30, partly because of what I remembered for that teachers gave me, and in self-education of just going, you know, I wish I was this interested in this when I was here. And one of the classes I took here at Marshall was children's literature. And I took it as a, you know, elective. I said, well, this is interesting. I'll take it. You know, it didn't really count. I learned so much that I use now from that, because the teacher I had then broke down children's stories. Not only did we read the stories, but broke down how everybody thinks they can write a kid's book because there's just a few words, and there was so much more to it. That helped me with comic books, especially letting pictures tell that story and you reinforce it and make sure your dialogue's that much more important. And if she were alive today, I'd love to thank her for that, because that was just everything she did in that class was just I've got to use in life and my job, which is huge.
We've definitely learned a lot about the love of the art form, finding your niche today, accountability, a lot about Wynonna Earp. And I do have to ask, who is your favorite character?
I exclude Wynonna because I created her, mm-hmm. so I always exclude her. I got to say, my favorite season was season one. That's when everything was fresh, new, and each character was starting to develop. And my favorite scene was the one with Tim Rozon as Doc Holliday and Michael Eklund as Bobo Del Rey in the camp towards the end, where it's intense and it's Revenant and him. What's going to happen? Are we going to side up? Or are we, you get in my way? I'm going to take that. To me, was some of the best acting in there. I would have to go with my buddy Tim Rozon as far as the character, just because I've read about Doc Holliday and Wyatt Earp so much since I was a kid, and they really captured it. But if I had to pick a second favorite, it'd be dumb Carl, stupid Carl. You know, he was just, I that was a character, if I were doing that, I would have had him run through all four seasons, always be in it. Is it kind of comic relief and maybe, you know, inform it, but I would have done anything to keep that character, just because he was a lovable bad guy in a way. And but that was, I know that's a lot, but that was one of my favorites there. And I'm getting ready to do ERPCon, Black Badge Division. It's going to be it's an ERP convention in Niagara Falls in May. And the nice part about that, I'm going to get to meet a lot of the cast members that weren't on the set the weeks that I was up there. So I'm really looking forward to that. That's going to be neat to get to finally, and some of them I put into the comics too. So, you know, get to find out how bad they hated it or liked it. So, but I'm looking forward to that. Greg Lawson, who plays Nedley, the sheriff, one of the funniest people you will ever meet. He's in a lot of stuff. He's one of these guys that works constantly. He's hilarious, great guy. Shamir Anderson, who played Dolls, was the first person I met on the set and stuff. And you've got this guy, you know, he's 6'3", you know, big, and he is the most lovable kid, but he has just done, his career after he left Wynonna has just skyrocketed, and he's in all kinds of stuff, great guy. Tim Rozon and we talk to each other every week. We are buddies, we are brothers. And Dominique, who plays Waverly, just, you talk about somebody that is walking their own life path. She's amazing in, I'm going to do this, and she sets out and she does it. Kat Burrell, you know, plays Hot. Kat's a born director as well. I mean, I think that's what she's going to end up in her career, which will be a long time. I think that's what she's going to end up really super being noted for. She's amazing with direction and stuff like that. And there's just so many characters. Michael Eklund plays Bobo Del Rey. Mean, I mean, just, you know, he's an intimidating. My wife and I were on the set for the first season. He was on the bridge doing this scene with a flamethrower, growling at the whole thing. He's got the big coat and the boots with the big heels, so he's really tall and on that. And it was a break, and they go, oh, you'll want to meet Michael right now. And I said, yeah, sure. And Beth goes, I don't know if I want to or not. And he is the most sweetest, creative guy. And I call him Mikey. I mean, he is, you can't imagine calling Bobo Del Rey Mikey, but he is one of the sweetest, most creative guy, can play anything. He works a lot. He's in a lot of different stuff and playing a lot of range. But again, one of the nicest people you'll ever meet. I mean, I did a convention with him in Louisville, and we did our panel together, and it's just listening to him tell anecdotes about acting and the craft of acting. He is a very serious actor, and just again, it was a master class of getting to do that and experience all that. At times I thought, well, I should give this money back to him for this, getting to do this. Beth reared me in on that, so it was wonderful.
Bobo was definitely one of my top favorite characters. He's always so intense.
Yes.
But it's fantastic to watch. And I actually went on to watch some of his other works just because of Bobo. And I've loved it.
Oh, if you ever get the chance to meet him at one of these things, convention stuff, please do. He's a wonderful person. I mean, you will just, he's excellent. And he always looks different. He's the one that developed the Bobo haircut. Put this white here and shave it over here on this. He gets into the role and he wants to make it his own and make it personable. Because in the comics, Bobo, is a big, long-haired, indescript. But he just really went at it. And Tim, his mustache is almost a character. And Tim can grow that in almost a week, it seems. He was at the house in December, and he just finished the convention. He always tries to grow it for a convention so that when he does photo ops, this is Doc. You can tell by the mustache. He was out in our front yard shaving it, just sitting there shaving it off. He goes, yeah, time to get rid of it. And I said, you sure you want to? He goes, yeah, I'll grow it back next week if I want. But he just goes in and shaves it. And I told him, I said, well, I'm going to gather up the hair and sell it on eBay then, bud. Good luck, Mr. Smith.
I had wondered if that was a fake mustache or not. So that's a fun tidbit to know. That's actually his facial hair.
That guy can grow a beard and mustache just like that. And you want long hair? Next week his hair, I wish I was like that. Trust me. He's funny. And again, all of them are people you'd love to meet. Anybody would love to meet. They are just, they all brought something to the table in that the television series. I mean, they really, we did our first convention, which was WonderCon in Anaheim, probably a few months before the show was ever shown. And we were at the booth signing and stuff, but no one, I heard this, this is based on Beau's comic book, Bob. That's basically all they knew. Those guys, the cast worked that. I mean, they were telling them, my character's gonna be this. It was and the lines weren't as big as they got after the show, because people found out who everybody was, and it was just wonderful. I mean, they just took to it. And a lot of, when I worked for McFarlane stuff, we did the Spawn movie and the HBO series and stuff, and there's been other things that I've worked on where we've dealt with acting and Hollywood, and I'll say Hollywood, American Hollywood. And some people, they always told me, if this would have been an American-made thing, you would have gotten your check, you would have been on the set, and that would have been it. Just no input. Emily Andrus and the production, everybody, they were so gracious. They involved me in everything, even in times where they didn't have to. I mean, it was amazing. That kind of kindness was just, wonderful. And again, everybody, aren't you sad that it's not on HBO or CBS or you name the thing? I said, nope, not a bit. I could make everything I've ever done. I could make it in Canada with Canadians, and it'd be great. It'd be an enjoyable experience. My dream, though, is, and a lot of people don't know this, I love Hallmark movies. Especially the Christmas ones, but all of them. And my buddies make fun of them. Because in comics, I was always known, breaking in the industry, as Beau Smith, last real man in comics. Because at that point, it was a lot of former hippies and artsy-fartsy and this, that, the other. And, I liked sports. I liked to fish. I liked to do. And they just took it, and I talked funny. So it was, it's just, it's all neat how it all works out. I mean, I could go on forever about that stuff, but it is just, it's a neat business. And I could always do it. Fine. I've done video games. That was fun. I haven't played one since Pong, but I had to have my son play it for me to get to the screenplay parts that I did, just so I could see it, because I was getting killed in the first 20 seconds and could go no further. So I got to do that. And again, that was from looking at a guy's portfolio in San Diego. And then 10 years later, he's an executive at Capcom and asked me, hey, want to write some video games? Sure, I'll try it, you know. So those things are great and they're fun, but comics is still the number one thing that I wake up to do every day. But every day but the weekend.
Fair. You need your recharge time, right? You got to have that time.
Yeah.
But is there any last anecdotes, thoughts, words of wisdom?
Don't open that door. I'll run through it.
I'm never going to close it.
It's funny. I always go back to, I wish I could time travel. I wish I could talk to sixth grade Beau Smith, who for my birthday, on my sixth, mom and dad, what do you want for your birthday? And I said, I want to call Stan Lee. And they're going, who? I want to call Stan Lee. He's the head of Marvel Comics. And this is 1966. And, you know, that's what I kept saying. Don't you want a bike? Nope. I want to call Stan Lee and talk to him about comics. So they got, you know, operator, got information and called Marvel Comics, you know, let me call Marvel Comics. And I was on the phone, and then Marvel Comics, can I help you? And it was Flo Steinberg, who is his assistant. And I didn't know, I thought it was the bullpen, like they said in the comics, all the artists and the writers are all there. Well, it was just Stan, Flo, and maybe two other people at that point. And I said, my name's Stephen Smith, and I'm in the sixth grade, and it's my birthday, and I wanted to talk to Stan Lee. And she was great. She was probably just out of college at that point. And she, well, Stan's in the next room writing the next issue of Spider-Man right now. Do you like Spider-Man? She talked to me for a half an hour on the phone. That was back when long distance cost money and everything. She was so nice to me. She asked me all about myself, questions. You know, I told her, I write stories all the time. Well, hopefully one day you'll write for Marvel Comics, you know, and you'll work for Stan. And, you know, she was wonderful to me. And I didn't get to talk to Stan, but, you know, she did ask address and name and all that stuff. And I hung up, and 2 weeks later, I was thrilled even just to talk to her because I'd seen her name in the comic books. 2 weeks later, I get a package in the mail, and it's a letter signed by Stan, Dear Steve Areno, and there was signed comic books in there. And that was the best birthday gift I ever had in my life. That's how bad I wanted it since I was a kid. And here, you know, 69 years old, and, you know, love it just as much. I actually, once I got in the industry, I did get to have lunch with Stan twice, me, him, and two other people. And I told him the story. Of course, you know, he meets a million people, he didn't remember that, but he was going, well, I was glad to be an influence, you know, this, because he was an influence. He sold at a time when DC Comics was bigger. And Marvel was, you know, they had 12 books a month and stuff. Stan did what I think he was my inspiration on marketing, one of the best marketing things. He sold Stan Lee. He sold himself. He was the face of it. He had Stan's soapbox. He was always given the other artists names and nicknames and stuff. He was always the face of Marvel Comics, because if you liked Stan Lee, then you would read Marvel Comics because he was like a friend. DC wasn't doing that. You didn't know who Julie Schwartz was or Mort Weisinger or any of those. You knew who Stan Lee was because he talked to you in the letters page in the comics every month. He was there. And, you know, in life, he's done the same thing even in his elderly years with the films and everything else of pushing Marvel. Always, I'm Stan Lee. That's the same thing almost to say in Marvel. So I got to meet him. And the other thing was, my first convention I ever went to before I was in the industry, I was on the shuttle bus going to Chicago Con in from the airport, and there was Stan Lee and his wife. I mean, not Stan Lee, Jack Kirby and his wife. And I recognized him. You know, I was a grown adult then, and I introduced myself to him. They couldn't have been nicer to me. He wanted to know everything about my life, what I was doing, what I was going to do there, and then my first convention too, takes me in. He goes, Beau's a personal friend of mine, and bang, got me through this. He goes, you come to my panel tomorrow. I went to his panel, he called on me. I mean, just treated me like family. And to the two biggest icons to me are Stanley and Jack Kirby, and to get to meet them and have interaction with them was like, okay, shoot me, it's done. You know, this is great. And it's just, you know, when I always say I'm blessed to be in this industry, and I wouldn't trade that stuff for anything. It's, you know, I hope other kids, hope my boys get some experience of like that while, you know, they're here to, I mean, that's, you know, it means a lot to me. It just, it really does. I hate to sound so cornball and childish maybe in a way, but that's what keeps me going. You ask what keeps me going? Well, that's the kind of stuff that keeps me going.
Well, I think that was the perfect bookend to this interview. There was no better cap that I could have put on it than everything that you just said.
It's like I said, Mac, I'm lucky.
It's, I think you have certainly sold the influence of the world of comics on everybody, regardless of if they are an avid reader, if they are a creator, or if they're just starting out their journey.
I hope, you know, more people in the industry, the better. And I just want to see kids, you know, create stuff. By kids, at my age, that could be anybody, you know, under the age of 69. So I just, the more the better. Because we never know when the next Stan Lee, the next Daredevil, the next Spider-Man, Superman could come from anybody.
Well, thank you so much for taking the time to meet with us today and share your world with us.
I appreciate everybody your else has a patience. Little... Trust me.
Oh, I loved it. I tell you. I really do. These interviews, they are what make my job worth it. They are what fuels my love of what I do. So thank you so much
for having me.
And if you would like to learn more about the world of comics or see Beau in person, you can actually join us at HerdCon on March 29th and 30th. We'll see you there.